This is Jazz Casual, and I'm Ralph Gleason. You've been listening to the Jerry Mulligan Quartet, one of the most delightful quartets in modern jazz today. They've been playing a composition by the leader, Jerry Mulligan, entitled 4x3. And now we're going to have a chance to talk to Jerry for a moment. Welcome to Jazz Casual, Jerry.
Thank you, Ralph.
You've been experimenting, it seems to me, with switching back and forth from large groups to small groups. Is there a reason for this other than economics?
Yeah, it's not really so much experimenting. I had the big band together for about 2 years.
Uh-huh.
And I got lonely for the little band again.
Why?
It's easier, and you wind up playing differently.
How do you play differently?
Well, a big band is more restricting because you have the more people you have in a band, the more organized the arrangements have to be.
Uh-huh.
With the quartet, we many times will decide to play a tune that we've never played before, and in front of an audience, we'll make up an arrangement as we go along.
Just like that?
And we did it sometimes with the big band too, but you have better luck and probably can be a bit more consistent with the small band.
Do you take things that you did with the big band and bring them down to the small group?
No, actually it's the other way around. We took small band things, a lot of the tunes that we played with the quartet for years. Uh-huh. I had arrangements made of those based on the quartet arrangement.
Does it give you problems in thinking about playing then, to play it first with the quartet and then go up to the big band and then back down?
Yes, it has. There's some of the things that, since we've gone back to playing them with the quartet, I think it happens to Bobby and I both, that we're so in the habit now of playing the big band arrangements of them that we miss the big band parts. In fact, it happened to me the other night. We were playing something that we'd played with the big band, and I totally forgot the quartet arrangement. I was all set to go into some band part of the thing that wasn't there. It's a bit of confusion.
Do you rehearse the things for the small group, too, at all?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, for instance, a thing like that 4-for-3 that we just mm-hmm. played is not something that you could start playing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the rehearsals are really mainly to learn the songs themselves. Mm-hmm. The arrangements are very sketchy and very fragmentary, which I'd prefer it that way, so we have more room to stretch out.
Well, now in a big band, would it be possible to stretch numbers out longer?
Oh, yes, sure.
Is it easier to do that with the small group than with the big band?
Well, that depends on the arrangements themselves. Some arrangements lend themselves to being added to and stretched out. One of the albums that we made with the big band was recorded on a concert tour. Uh-huh. It was called the Concert Jazz Band on Tour. And in going over the material for the album and editing the stuff and hearing all of the various tapes from the various places, I thought it would be a good idea to include two tracks of the same piece on it, mm-hmm. because in that way it illustrated better than you could with words how differently the same arrangement could mm-hmm. sound on a different night under different circumstances. And as it happens, the thing we played is a blues thing called Go Home, which was based on a blues tune of Ben Webster's. And we wound up playing it so differently, leaving parts of it out and playing at a different tempo and adding sections to it, that it's almost a totally different piece.
This all depends on your mood at the moment, how things feel to you. And
mm-hmm.
so. Do you do this with the small group too?
Oh, yes.
Can you change around like
sure.
that?
Sure.
Do you, you must have, all musicians do, I'm sure, I thought about what the future of jazz is going to be, where this music that you've been involved in all your life is going to go. Do you have any concepts of what this is going to be like?
Well, I guess most of the concepts I have of it are personal,
yeah.
because I'm not very concerned with what jazz does as a whole. I'm only concerned with my own, where I'm going and
where
I'm
going. Where does it go for Jerry Mulligan?
Yes. Yeah. I think that's true of anybody that's involved with it. My personal involvement is such that I don't really think too much about what anybody else is doing. Mm-hmm. Of course, there's another side to that, too. I haven't had much inspiration to think much about what anybody else is doing because I don't really like a lot of the directions that jazz has taken in the last 5 or 6 years.
Uh-huh. Such as?
Well, I think that there's a bit more concentrating on such things as funk and hard blowing and soul for the sake of itself that they've kind of lost me. To me, there's a lot of different ways to play, and I don't like to see these trends of people getting isolated into their little rut. You mm-hmm. know, to me, if you're in a rut, you're in a rut, and it doesn't matter whether that rut is far out or far in.
Yeah. It's restrictive in any sense.
And also the need to intellectualize about mm-hmm. jazz, and let's everybody sit down and write a symphony.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a great deal of that, and I think most of it is bound to be unsuccessful,
mm-hmm.
because the techniques just don't go together.
You look for more freedom in personal playing, then?
Well, I don't know if you can put it that way, because some of the attempts at freedom, or complete yeah. freedom,
yeah.
say, are chaotic. Yeah. I think one of the things about jazz that's attractive is the order of it. It is orderly, it should be. And organized, and inside that order, you have a great deal of freedom. But you can't truly have freedom unless you've got order to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One of the things that people mention to me when they talk of the Jerry Mulligan small groups is the fact that you don't use a piano player. Why is this?
Well, of course, in the first place, you don't need a piano. For that matter, I guess you don't really need any particular instrument, but it's become a habit of thinking to have the piano in the rhythm section. And it occurred to me that the piano was being used as a crutch for the other instruments, because the piano sits and has a function where he's playing the chords all the time. And I found that a great deal of the time he was getting in my way.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not necessarily something that I recommend for all of jazz. I should, you know, I should start saying, piano players are out. No more pianos in jazz, right?
Ah, but you play the piano yourself.
Well, that's the other reason. You see, if with the small band, if I ever want to get a chance to play the piano, if I have a piano player there, I'd never have the heart to tell him, say, get up, I want to play now. But Bobby and I both play with the group, and it makes for a bit of variety for us and a chance to put our horns down once in a while, and it also changes the sound of the group.
Are you going to play something for us now in which you do touch the piano?
Yes,
lightly?
I'm going to play a ballad on Darn That Dream.
I'd love to hear it.
Thank you.
Jerry Mulligan and his quartet with Gus Johnson on drums and Bob Brookmeyer on trombone and Wyatt Reuther on bass and Jerry Mulligan on baritone and piano are going to play Darn That Dream. Thank you.
For our last selection, we're going to play a composition written by Bob Brookmeyer entitled Open Country.
Thank you.